Israel, Jacob, Ephraim, and Judah.
I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of compassion, with the bands of love, and I became to them as one who uses the yoke on their God, and I bent down to them and fed them.
Okay, notice, what a poignant passage.
Israel was a child, think of it. Israel was a child, I loved it. And out of Egypt, I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. What a poignant passage, I think.
Okay, now, would you turn to Matthew? Matthew's Gospel. Would you look at chapter 2,
13,
chapter 2 of Matthew, and then tonight, verse 15. Let's start with 13.
When they had departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother, flee to Egypt, and stay there until I tell you. Herod is going to search for the child to destroy him." Joseph rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt. He stayed there until the death of Herod, that what the Lord had said through prophets might be fulfilled. Out of Egypt I called my son.
Okay, I'm taking you here with that. Notice, out of Egypt I called my son. Where does that come from?
Okay.
Comes from Hosea, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, do you still have Hosea, Mark? Okay. Hosea 11. What's Hosea 11 talking about?
The Exodus.
The Exodus, right? What's predicted?
That of Egypt.
What is predicted?
He shall return to the land of Egypt.
Interesting, because that's right. Verse 5.
Did we ever get that far?
No, we didn't. Joan's getting ahead of us, and this is just 5, because that's right. Now, notice. But it says, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. That's talking about the past. Agreed?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But the prophet said this was to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet. out of Egypt I have called my son. Notice, prophecy is not prediction, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Prophets don't predict. And prophecy is not prediction. Prophecy is the word of God, and it's a message. If you will, it's a promise. And I like the explanation one scholar gave. He said, most parents tell children, if you don't behave thus and so, this consequence will occur. He said, God's prophecies are like that. In other words, they're, if you will, first of all, they're depend on a circumstance. Second, they're not predictions, they're promises or warnings. And so, remember what was promised from Abraham on? nations will be blessed. That's the promise that is going to continue. And ultimately, that's what you're reading in Matthew. I hope I'm going to show you that by the time you get there so that it will be very clear, not vague. Okay? All right? Let's go back to Exodus. Starting now when Moses goes to Pharaoh, Moses says, who is Yahweh? I don't know him. That's verse 2 of chapter 5. Okay, read it, Jim, would you? Chapter 2, verse 5.
Pharaoh answered, who is the Lord that I should heed his plea to let Israel go? I do not know the Lord. Even if I did, I would not let Israel go.
Okay. All right. Now, there's a, can I say, there's a God calling contest that follows. Do you know what I mean by that? Okay. Okay, for instance, I'm not going to go through all of this, but Moses calls upon God, and the water turns to blood. Okay? Pharaoh's magicians, the wise men, what did they do?
Turn it red.
They turned the river to blood.
They turned the water to blood. Now, don't ask me where they got more water. But notice, they're competing here. And what do you mean by competing? The gods. Which god is stronger? You with me? Okay. All right. Now, then, what was the purpose of this? Jim, I'm going to ask you to follow me here, and I'm going to be jumping around. We're in chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse, start with verse 6.
Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord. I will free you from forced labor of the Egyptians and deliver you from their slavery. I will rescue you by my outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and you shall have me as your God. You will know that I, the Lord, am your God.
Okay, now, skip then to chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 5.
So that the Egyptians may learn that I am the Lord, as I stretch out my hand against Egypt and lead the Israelites out of their midst.
Okay, notice. So that you will know that I am Yahweh, the Lord, right? So that the Egyptians will know, verse 17. Chapter 7, verse 14.
14.
Mm-hmm. 7, 14.
Then the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh is obdurate in refusing to let people go.
Okay, skip to verse 17.
The Lord now says, this is how you shall know that I am the Lord. I will strike the water of the river with a staff I hold, and it shall be changed into blood.
Okay, notice. So that you, Moses, will know. So that the people will know. So that Pharaoh will know. So that you yourself will know. Right? Okay. Now, would you look with me at chapter 8, Jim?
The Lord then told Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your hand and your staff over the streams,
okay,
and canals and pools.
I want you to go to chapter 8.
No.
Yeah, that's what I just
that was.
Okay, verse 10.
Verse 10. Heaps and heaps of them were gathered up, and there was a stench in the land. But when the Pharaoh saw that there was a respite, he became obdurate and would not listen to them, just as the Lord had foretold.
Okay, I guess you need to start with verse 9.
Verse 9. And the Lord did as Moses had asked. The frogs in the houses and courtyards.
Okay,
and the fields died off.
I'm sorry, verse 8 again.
After Moses and Aaron left Pharaoh's presence, Moses implored the Lord to fulfill the promise he had made to Pharaoh about the frog.
I'm sorry, Jim, what's happening? Chapter 8?
Chapter 8.
Is that chapter 8?
Yes.
Okay, what I'm looking at is verse 10 in my version. And it says, and he said, tomorrow Moses said, as you say, so that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God.
That's 6.
That's 6.
That's
tomorrow, said Pharaoh.
The heaps and heaps.
Then Moses replied, it shall be as you have said, so that you may learn that there is none like the Lord our God.
That's right. That's what I'm saying.
Verse 6.
That's verse 6. It's a different verse.
Yeah.
Okay. See, that happens sometimes when we're dealing with different versions. And by the way, you know that the Bible was not divided into chapters or verses until the Renaissance. So when somebody, remember the Jewish people, memorized this, memorize the sacred scripture. And so when in the book of Hebrew, I love this passage, it has been said somewhere, what is man that you are mindful of, and not the son of man that you pay heed to him? And have made him a little lower than the angels. It has been said somewhere. He knew it, but he had no idea where it was from. How would you say it? You're referring to a whole book. You see what I mean? So, okay, so they're variations. Okay, Jim, chapter 8, let's try verse 22.
But Moses replied, it is not right to do so, for the sacrifices we offer to the Lord our God are the abomination to the Egyptians. If before their very eyes we offer sacrifices, which are an abomination to them, will not the Egyptians stone us?
Apparently we're still off somehow. I'm going to read the one that I'm referring to. But on that day I will set apart the land of Goshen, where my people live, so that no swarms of flies shall be there, that you may know that I, the Lord, and in this land.
18.
What verse is that in yours?
18. 18.
18. Oh, wow. Okay. Now, notice, you'll continue to get more specific, and at the same time, watch, you're going to get more general. So, there are two things I want to call to your attention. The plagues are called signs. What's a sign?
A message.
The plague's a message. You're seeing, I'm showing you what the message is. Do you follow me? The message is Yahweh is God, that you may know that Yahweh is God. Moses, Pharaoh, all the people, that you may know that Yahweh is in this land. Why is that such a statement? Yahweh is in this land. Because, remember I told you, when you leave the land, you leave the God. You know the story of Jonah. God said, go and preach to the Ninevites. What did Jonah do?
Ran away.
He went the opposite direction and got out of the country. But he found out God was on the sea as well. So notice this is a big deal. All right, I'm going to read again. Chapter 9. And in mine is verse 14. For this time I will send all my plagues upon you yourself and upon your officials, upon your people. Notice that's to Pharaoh. so that you may know that there is no one like me in all the earth. Do you see what's, where is that in yours?
14.
What, which one? 14?
14.
Okay. Ah, same verse here. Okay, Jim, keep reading.
For by now, I would have stretched out my hand and struck you as your subjects with such pestilence as you would wipe from the earth. But this is why I have spared you, to show you my power and to make my name resound throughout the earth.
Throughout the earth, make my name resound throughout the earth. Remember the Abrahamic covenant? Do you see what I'm getting at?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, keep reading.
Do you still block the way for my people by refusing to let them go? I warn you then.
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I warn you then, tomorrow at this hour I will rain down such fierce hail as there has never been in Egypt, from the day the nation was founded up to the present.
Verse 20.
Some of Pharaoh's servants feared the warning of the Lord and hurried their servants and livestock off to shelter. Others, however, did not take the warning of the Lord to heart and left their servants and livestock in the fields.
Okay, verse 27.
Then Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said to them, I have sinned again. The Lord is just. It is I and my subjects who are at fault.
Ah, notice, Pharaoh says this. And then notice, okay, skip to verse 29.
Moses replied, as soon as I leave the city, I will extend my hands to the Lord.
By the way, Pharaoh changed his mind. Go ahead.
The thunder will cease and there will be no more hail. Thus you shall learn that the earth is the Lord's.
Notice, and verse 34.
But Pharaoh, seeing that the rain and hail and thunder had ceased, sinned again.
Okay, all right. Chapter 10, verse 2.
And that you may recount to your son and your grandson how ruthlessly I dealt with the Egyptians and what signs I wrought among them, so that you may know that I am the Lord.
Do you see the refrain? So that you're, okay, verse 7.
But Pharaoh's servant said to him, how long must he be a menace to us? Let the men go to worship the Lord their God. Do you not yet realize that Egypt is being destroyed? So Moses and Aaron were brought back to Pharaoh, who said to them, you may go and worship your Lord, your God. But how many of you will go?
Okay, notice, not everybody's to go. Again, you have the, okay, you see the pattern, don't you? Okay, let's move on. Okay, then I want you to skip to chapter 12. Okay, there's the Passover, and remember the firstborn of all the Egyptians is killed. Okay, Jim, chapter 12, start with verse 33.
The Egyptians likewise urged the people on to hasten their departure from the land. They thought that otherwise they would all die. The people therefore took their dough before it was leavened, and their kneading bowls wrapped in their cloaks on their shoulders. The Israelites did as Moses had commanded. They asked for the Egyptians for articles of silver and gold and for clothing. The Lord indeed had made the Egyptians so well disposed toward the people that they let them have whatever they asked for. Thus did they despoil the Egyptians.
Okay, remember, God said right at the beginning, you will despoil the Egyptians. And I told you, the church fathers used that as an image for our taking in the wisdom of other traditions. Remember, Christianity was not did not come into being in a vacuum. Christianity was at first a part of Judaism, right?